We are going to start with just a session to make sure that everybody is up with installing VPP. Most of you probably followed the steps on the wiki to install VPP in a VM using Vagrant. But we know lots of people have issues when they do that. There are bugs, etc. So we have right now 1 hour session just to make sure that everybody is up to speed. And we don't leave everybody behind, like the first session. That would be a pity. You can go to this page on the wiki. So setting up your dev environment. For those of you who are not who don't know Vagrant, Vagrant is a way to easily spawn VMs based on files. So those files are called Vagrant files. So they are files which include all the specific configuration to your VM. And so when you go to the directory where there is a Vagrant file and you do Vagrant up, it's going to create the VM. First of all, to create the Vagrant, we need to download VPP, the source code of VPP, because the Vagrant file is within the Git repository. So actually, we need to install Vagrant as well. So first, for those who don't have Vagrant, go to the Vagrant website, download it. Because we had so many problems with Vagrant and Windows, I will actually suggest you a different approach. You know how to install a Ubuntu VM. Let's do that. Because we are going to install a Ubuntu VM with the desktop you like, the environment you like. We are going to download the sources within that VM and build it from within that VM, because Vagrant and Windows, we have different issues. You know that. So yeah, just download Ubuntu and install a VM from scratch. Meanwhile, the people who have good operating systems can install Vagrant. So download Vagrant. And then we can go to the next step, which you can actually do while Vagrant is installing. It's download the source code. So here you can do that if you have a Linux Foundation ID, you can do it with SSH. If you do not have a Linux Foundation ID, you can use HTTPS anonymously. So I'm going to do it just for kicks because my setup is already working. If at some point I'm going too fast, please shout, because I don't exactly know what pace I should go to make sure that everybody is following. But normally, the steps are, on this wiki page, you can find a lot of information, but normally it can be just as simple as these 5 steps when everything works. So right now we are at the Git clone step. Once you have the sources available, you go to the VPP, so the sources directory. You go to build root, that's where the building files are, and you go to Vagrant. And you go to this directory where you will find a Vagrant file. It's in vpp/build root/vagrant. You will find a Vagrant file. And so if we look at that Vagrant file, contains a bunch of information about what Vagrant should do when it's time to create the VM. So this is the Vagrant file. You find different information, like what Vagrant is supposed to run when start the VM. So the information that matters to you are mostly these, like how many NICs you want your VM to have. Like if you put 2, then your VM is going to have two virtual NICs, E1000. So these are E1000 because DPDK works on with them. So we can actually have DPDK drivers running on virtual NICs. And so if you put different numbers, then your VM is going to have more NICs or less. Those NICs are connected to a private network, which gets DHCP. You can set up a proxy. Well, that is to set up a proxy. You can change the amount of memory and CPUs you want to give to your VM, depending on your own laptop, how much you can give as memory as CPU. So here the configuration are a bit different, depending on whether you use VirtualBox, VMware, libvirt. So make sure that if you want to modify these, you don't have to, but if you want to modify these, make sure to do it in the right place. So now that we picked a look at Vagrant file, I mean, we are in the right directory, VPP, build root, Vagrant. We just need to do Vagrant up. And now Vagrant is going to download Ubuntu image and set up a VM. We can actually, so right now it's doing VirtualBox headless, but we can actually start VirtualBox and see that Vagrant is doing something with that VM. So that's the other one I already installed. And that's actually the one Vagrant is currently installing. And we can see that the amount of memory corresponds to the one we gave in the Vagrant file, the amount of processors as well. And we can go to the network configuration and we see that we have the main NIC, which is the one that is providing internet access. That's the default one. And we have two additional E1000 NICs, which are connected to a private network. So, please tell if you have any questions. I'm just going to interrupt this one because I have the other one that already works. And I will switch to the other one. So I can save a little bit of bandwidth for you. So for Apple, people who have Apple systems, maybe you will have to make the following change. I will show you. It's a problem I faced with the Vagrant shared directories. Here, those two lines, I modified them. You can find the details of the modification in the wiki page, on the wiki page. It's explained here. So the thing is that on my system, I've never heard anybody complain about the same problem. So I don't know if it's just me, but you may want to put absolute path for your shared directories. So there is the shared slash vagrants or slash VPP. By default, it's this. It's a relative path and it doesn't work for me. So you may just try to do vagrant up. And if it doesn't work, try this fix. Just put an absolute path for slash vagrant, which goes to the vagrant directory within VPP sources tree. And for the slash VPP directory, put the same absolute path, but just stop at the VPP directory. So normally, once a Vagrant op is going to install the VM and do everything you need. I mean, it's the scripts are bootstrapped, bootstrap VPP. It compiles it, and if you have Vagrant op that finishes without problems, we are done. So once you have Vagrant op ready, I mean, once it finishes, you can do Vagrant SSH. I didn't do Vagrant op. So that's also an issue I have with my own setup. I don't know why it's taking time here. Eventually it stops and I'm good to SSH. So if you have particular issues with Vagrant, please file Jira bugs, because we know there are many issues, but it's hard to track them, given that they are different on different systems. And so if we have clear logs that tells us what's going wrong, it helps. Since we have some time to kill, jira.fd.io, I think there is no session that are going to explain you that. So you log in with your Linux Foundation ID, and in projects, you go to VPP, and there you can file, well, you see there are already plenty of bugs and features, requested features, and you can just create a new issue here, and I'm going to do this. And then you just have to file the details of your problem and your the feature you want. You can give a description, you can assign to someone or just leave it there. And at some point we do assign, complete, and close. Oh, that was easy. Let's do here. When you boot Vagrant for the first time, VPP I think will be running. You can just do a stop VPP. So for me it's not running because it's not the first time I boot the VM. But you can do start VPP, stop VPP. So here it started. I need to do sudo. Here it is. And sudo stop VPP. So when you do start and stop VPP, it actually looks like it looks to etc VPP startup config. Oh, good. And in there, you have this file contains the command line arguments that are given to VPP. You can find further documentation on the wiki about that, but we are going to go in much more details. Maybe Damien is going to talk a bit about that. Any further presentations, we are going to have details about what we can put here. Like when you want to do DPDK stuff, it's going to be a DPDK part. So we have sections, and each section can have different arguments. And when you want to have like commands that are executed at boot, that's also where we can put it. But I'm not going to say too much about that right now. So these command lines, you can actually, if you want, stop VPP and start it directly as a binary. When you go to the VPP directory, build root, install VPP native, you can go to VPP, bin, and then you have this VPP, which is actually the VPP process. This is the binary. You can find it so in /build/root/install/vpp-native/vpp/bin/vpp. So when you install the Debian package, which is done when you Debian or RPM, which is done when you use Vagrant, it's actually going to install this in your binaries. But for testing, I find it myself more handy to actually execute the binary directly rather than having it running as a daemon and so on. So run. Ah, okay. Well, yeah, I can do either. Yes, indeed. Yep. Yeah. So right now, I showed you how to run VPP using make run. So I stopped it. If you do the other ways, like sudo start VPP, then you can use a binary called vppctl, which does exactly the same thing as when you have VPP running in the console, and when you type a CLI, you can do exactly the same thing, but with vppctl, sudo vppctl, and it just shows you the output of the command you just typed on VPP. So this way you can have VPP running in background and use vppctl to use the CLI, the VPP CLI.